Welcome to the Daedalus presentation. Daedalus is Descent and Exploration in Deep Autonomy of Lava Underground Structures. My name is Andreas Nüchter and I had the pleasure to lead a marvelous team of international scientists. Let's consider Daedalus in relation to the ESA exploration program. On the left side, we list the objective of Daedalus, on the right side, the ESA exploration program. Daedalus aims at exploration of the evolution of the volcanisms through windows within the lava flow succession of Luna Maria. We want to generate a 3D map based on LIDAR and structure for motion data. Daedalus wants to analyze fresher samples from deeper locations less affected by space weathering and to detect the presence of volatiles within the cave. We want to carry out research on locally sourced resources that can be integrated in crewed mission architecture. We plan to identify and to characterize of at least one pyroglite and pyroclastic deposit. We want to explore subsurface environment conditions. The minimum viable science return level consists of reaching the edge of the pit and perform an initial descent. While this, we study the surface volcanic geomorphology and characterize surface regolith. We perform a first multispectral panoramic view and of the volcanic environment at the cave entrance and a first high-res 3D reconstruction of the cave entrance. We carry out a first stratigraphic interpretation. The nominal mission science return consists of reaching the bottom of the pit and performing a tethered exploration. We map the pit walls and the bottom floor in 3D. We detect potential pyroglite and potential pyroclastic deposits. We create a temperature and radiation profile during descent, and we do a first estimation of the dimension of the lunar cave. The extended mission science return includes untethered and tunneled navigation. Here, we do a first high-res 3D reconstruction of a lunar cave and evaluate the stability of the cave ceiling. We create horizontal profiles of temperature and radiation along the tunnel and evaluate the cave trafficability. We study the cave floor mechanical properties, take multispectral images, and study volcanic rocks and debris in the cave. We used a digital terrain model derived from stereo observation of the high-resolution camera on board the Lunar Reconnaissance Orbiter. By combining the stereo images with the illumination conditions, we were able to create a high-detailed terrain from which we automatically extracted the location all the possible navigation obstacles, such as impact craters and depressions, and calculated their depths. Along with this, slope thresholds for trafficability have been defined in a conservative fashion, taking as reference the slope navigation threshold of the Mars rovers. We were therefore able to define a hazard map with no-go areas and potential hazardous regions, as well as define a landing ellipse of 150 times 250 meters in the safest area, the closest to the pit. As a side note, we can also say that boulder hazards in this particular region is not an issue, since it's virtually boulder-free or have boulders with size below the image resolution, therefore of 10 to 40 centimeters maximum in diameter. The high incidence angle observations were used in order to get an accurate image of the bottom of the pit. With the sun close to the vertical, it's possible to see both the bottom of the pit and preserve some shadows useful to detect the boulders. They were manually mapped on the images with a resolution of 45 cm per pixel, highlighted in the red in the second image. In the third image, a density map of the boulder weighted on the diameter is presented. It is clear that the ideal location to deploy the sphere would be the northwestern sector of the pit as it's free of large boulders as marked by the white square. The chart on the right displays the power slope of the boulder diameter versus their cumulative number. The power slope predicts the amount of boulders or pebble of a certain size to be extended below the image resolution. Essentially, it shows that the area marked by the white square will present a number of boulders of few tens of centimeters size at maximum, and it confirms it is the most ideal for ground navigation. The Daedalus Science requirements are: first, we require the panoramic images of the pit during the descent as a resolution better than 0.1 degree per pixel. Second, we need to take color images obtained with four different filters in the 0.4 to 0.9 micrometer wavelength range. Third, we aim at performing a photogrammetric 3D reconstruction with an accuracy of less than 10 centimeters at 5 meters distance. We want to do SLAM mapping of the pit during the descent with 1K points per square meter. We need to carry out long-range LiDAR surveys of the cave from the tethered and from tripod positions. Daedalus uses at least two different LiDAR wavelengths and an illuminator for optical cameras in shadowed areas in the pit and tunnel. With accelerometers, a soil strength analysis is done, a thermometer captures additional environmental conditions, and a dosimeter the radiation level. Concerning the optical requirements useful to retrieve compositional information, we suggest the use of four filters, centered at 480 nanometers, 600 nanometers, 700 nanometers, and 830 nanometers. Of the retrievable spectral parameters, the UV and VIS spectral slope is indicative of layer maturity, grain size, and illuminate content. High reflectance values joined at attenuated 600 to 700 nanometer slopes are potential associated with pyroclastic materials. The higher the reflectance at the 700 nanometers, the lower the titanium and iron oxide abundances. Finally, the 750-830 nanometer slope, which points to the 1 micrometer absorption strength, is indicative of the maverick minerals abundance. LiDAR return signals are thought to be employed for water detection. It is known that water ice reflectance tends to dramatically decrease towards near-infrared wavelengths, where both water ice and illuminate similarly decrease the average reflectance of any surface. In order to discern water ice contribution by illuminate contribution, we suggest to use a red near-infrared ratio. The higher the ratio, the higher the ice content. Specifically, an orange or red laser would be centered where the water ice reflectance is still very high, but the illuminate signal is low. Differently, a 1535 nanometer laser is centered where one of the main water ice absorptions arises and the illuminate signal is still low. This means that a particularly high ratio would be indicative of water ice where the ratio is close to the unit with generally low input values would suggest illuminate presence. The mission consists of four phases. Phase 1 is the skyline approach and descender deployment. Phase 2 is the skyline descent and mapping. In phase 3, we enter the main void and do mapping from the descender tethered, the main cave environment, and in phase 4, we detach from the tether to the horizontal navigation and tunnel mapping. Let's look at the overall design. The overall form is still a sphere as presented in the initial proposal. For better understanding, the outer shell and the coverage of the inner shell are hidden. There are two main design drivers, locomotion and sensors. For locomotion, two approaches are chosen, a locomotion by changing the center of mass and by rods. Therefore, an inner and an outer structure exists, which are rotatable relative to each other. We say relative because which parts remain horizontal and which rotates relative to the environment changes from mode to mode. The other locomotion is done by rods. Because a laser scanner scans through the space between the rods, this leads to seeing star shapes of the rods. Furthermore, we got two LiDARs and four hyperhemispherical lenses. The interaction between all parts are now shown in an animation. First, you see the descending mode. The sphere at the tether is lowered in the pit, and the scanner and the cameras capture the pit walls. Here we show the LiDAR coverage, and here we show the optical coverage. When reaching the bottom, we do decoupling, change the center of mass by rotating the batteries, and flip the sphere in a horizontal fashion. From this horizontal position, we can get into rolling mode by using the inner structure. Here we have mainly an horizontal LiDAR coverage. And we show the optical coverage. When using the rods as a tripod, we can rotate the inner structure and perform three-dimensional 3D scans just as a terrestrial laser scan. We also can show the camera, the optical coverage. The rods can also be used for overcoming obstacles as shown in this figure. Steering can be done by changing the weight distribution of the sphere. The rods are still at tier L1, as we know which requirements we have, but still further research need to be done into the realization. For better grip and stability, there will be pads on the tip of each rod. Because this brings the risk of getting stuck, there will be an emergency disengagement procedure, so the corresponding rod is ejected. So the overall mission can still go on. Currently, we look into hydraulic and electric solutions for the rod. A key component is the LiDAR subsystem. After an evaluation, we have decided against a conventional LiDAR with a rotating mirror or a multi-plane LiDAR. Instead, we suggest a so-called prism scanner, where two rotating prisms are used to deflect the laser beam. The resulting scan pattern is given on the next slide, at the bottom right. The main function of the LiDAR subsystem is to acquire direct visual 3D information, that is to capture the geometry of the environment and to do a multispectral analysis. A prototype prism-based LiDAR system has been tested to evaluate the feasibility of scan-matching-based SLAM algorithms. The camera subsystem consists of hyperhemispheric lens inside the Daedalus casing. They have a very wide field of view, that is 360 times 260 degrees. When put opposite to each other, we even yield a stereo area of 360 times 80 degrees. A parametric analysis shows that even a small baseline of the two cameras of a stereo rig, such as 20 cm, yields an accuracy of 10 cm in a distance of 5 meters. We studied potential risks. Here we just list one, namely the dust removal. Its severity is high, and the final report lists a number of potential methods to overcome it. However, none of the methods is space qualified, and thus further research is needed. A key technology in exploration robotics is autonomy. It is needed since neither direct control nor supervisory control are sufficient for lunar exploration. The robot will be capable of planning its exploration path automatically, thus performing intelligence exploration using LiDAR-based simultaneous localization and mapping. Daedalus includes fault management. For example, the rods will be removed in case of a defect or if the robot got stuck. The Daedalus OSIP study has shown that a spherical robot is well suited for lunar exploration and that this robot type should further be studied. The robot can be used for many firsts in lunar science and exploration. We have identified and parameterized the external interfaces in OCDT to achieve full compliance.